Yes. Good. Keep fighting. Get butt. One more. Sit back. Back. Vertical shin. Chest up. Chest up. Chest up. Chest up. Good.
Stay with it. Take that face. Hey guys, Jordan Winkler here, and I'm here with Matt Reynolds. I'm going to briefly introduce Matt and then ask you to talk a little bit about your background. Okay. Matt is an elite athlete and strength coach. Is that okay?
Sure.
Appropriate to call you that? And a lot of times I get questions about fitness related things, and a lot of times my answers are it depends. And that's for a couple reasons, but I want you to know right off the bat that when I have a question, it's you who I ask.
Yep.
Even though I think that our styles are kind of different,
sure.
The principles are very similar.
Yeah, so definitely.
Go ahead and tell us about your background.
Yeah, well, thanks for calling me an elite athlete. I would call myself an ex-elite athlete, so I'm getting old now. But no, I got into strength training after high school. Going into college, I wasn't really good enough to play anything in college sports, and so I got into the sport of powerlifting and totaled elite in powerlifting, which is kind of the top level of certification in powerlifting, I think in 2001, 2002, somewhere in there. And continued to compete in powerlifting at a high level until 2005. In 2005, I turned my attention to a strongman, like the world's strongest man that you see, and won my professional status in strongman in 2006. Competed on that circuit, the professional circuit, from 2006 through 2009. In 2008, I opened up a gym called Strong Gym, and grew that actually to the largest strength gym in the country, that I ended up selling in December of last year, or December of 2015. And since then, I have done online coaching since the late 90s, actually, but on a full-time basis since January 2016. And so I've kind of run the gamut from business owner, gym owner, kind of top-level strength athlete, and then strength and conditioning coach. I have, you know, 20, 30,000 hours worth of coaching under my belt. And so, I would love to say that I'm just naturally a great coach, but the reality is that I've probably just done it more than most people, so, or maybe anybody on earth. And so I've been coming down to Tactical Response now for a couple of years, teaching a Fight Strong class and teaching normal people how to be harder to kill, which I think is an incredibly important goal to accomplish. And so for a lot of these guys, they have a lot of skill and a lot of training, and even the right mindset when it comes to the martial lifestyle in the tactical world, as long as it stays in the tactical world. And as soon as it becomes physical, for most of these guys and ladies, if they're honest with themselves, it's probably the weak link. And so we're trying to bring up that weak link and make them harder to kill.
Okay. And you spent some time as a teacher.
Yeah, for 10 years I was a public school teacher, and I was also a head strength coach for a large 4A high school, about 1,600 kids in Missouri, and that definitely also helped my strength and conditioning prowess. Certainly isn't optimal having 60 high school kids in a weight room and you're coaching them all at the same time, but it made me a very efficient and effective coach, just because really out of necessity. So yeah, I've done that as well.
Okay, excellent. So I wrote down a bunch of questions that I would like to personally ask
you,
and that I think will be interesting for our audience as well. So, what is something that you used to believe about strength training that you no longer believe, or you now view as incorrect or not the best way?
Sure. I used to believe that accessory movements, so those movements that are not the big compound barbell movements, but movements that still most people do, were necessary to bring up overall strength in the compound barbell movements. And the longer I coach and the longer I train, I really believe that most accessory movements are utterly and totally worthless. and that the focus should really 90% of the time be on the large barbell movements. The squat, the deadlift, the bench press, and the press.
Worthless in the pursuit of strength?
Yeah, worthless in the pursuit of strength, right? So, if you look at like physical attributes that I'm trying to, there are a lot of physical attributes I can try to build. So strength is one of those. I actually think strength is the most important one because strength makes all the other ones better. But I can bring up mobility, and I can bring up power, and I can bring up speed, and I can bring up agility. There's all of those, conditioning, endurance, accuracy, all that kind of balance. All of those things can be brought up. I honestly believe that strength makes all of those better, and it's not a two-way street. So, for example, if you take somebody who really is an untrained person and you teach them how to squat with a full range of motion, their mobility will get better. But if you take that same person and decide to not have them strength train and you have them go do yoga, their flexibility and mobility will get far better, but they're not going to be any stronger. right? So I'm really trying to get the greatest bang for my buck, the best return on my investment. And so, but even in the weight room, I mean, I start to think about things that I used to do all the time, like some of those machine type things. So leg extensions, leg curls, you know, rows, glute ham raises.
So accessory work would be defined as anything outside of the squat.
Yeah, outside the major barbell compound movements. Okay. And it's not that those things are completely worthless, and there definitely is still a reason to do those and to bring up work capacity, and maybe there's certain points. But when you look at like weak point training, which is the way I used to use them, I think I've just seen that you would be far better off spending more time on the main lifts and focusing on the main lifts. It would be better to, instead of squat one time a week and then spend another time a week doing leg presses and glute ham raises and leg curls and leg extensions, you would be better off squatting two times a week. And that would bring up both leg strength, leg size, and overall strength.
Okay, okay. So what is the best $100 purchase, $500 purchase, and $1,000 fitness-related purchase that you've made in the last year?
That's a good question. Okay, so let's start big and work small.
Okay.
Okay. $1,000 purchase, $1,000 will put together a home gym. Not the greatest home gym of all time, but you can definitely put together a nice home gym so that you don't have to travel to a gym. And the primary piece for that is going to be a rack, a power rack, a squat rack, which I would get from Rogue Fitness or Titan Fitness. You can get an incredible squat rack from Rogue for about $695. You can get a knockoff of that rack from Titan Fitness for, I think, around $400. The difference is Rogue's going to be made in America. It's going to have laser cut holes. The Titan one's going to be in made from China, and it's going to be just drill pressed. But it's still, both are pretty good pieces of equipment. So so a squat rack platform would be my, you know, the kind of big thing. And I did that. I put together, when I sold my gym a year ago, I put together a home gym for myself, and I outfitted it completely from Rogue Fitness. I've got a great big nice rack, love it. $500 purchase, the best thing in that ballpark is a B&R bar from Rogue Fitness, barbell. So barbells to strength guys and fitness guys are sort of like guns to you guys, right? So we have too many of them.
Right.
You know, you need one good one, and we all have 15.
Right.
It's one of those. And so a B&R bar, that stands for a Bergener and Ripiteau bar, but for short they call it B&R. That's $295, it's a pretty good price. That barbell will be passed down to your kids and grandkids. It will never bend. It's an incredibly high performing bar. You know, handles chalk, handles the outside. You can put it in your garage, it's not gonna rust. So that's probably about the best thing. And then on a cheaper scale, a pair of squat shoes. A pair of squat shoes. So when we wear squat shoes, if you haven't seen them before, they're very flat-soled shoes. I mean, very, very flat on the bottom, but they actually have a bit of a heel in the back, and it helps to set the shin angle correctly on a squat so that you can get just enough shin angle so that you can sit back and take the pressure off of your knees and put it on your hips, in your posterior, your chain, your butt, and hamstrings. So really, if most people start with a good squat rack, a good barbell, and a pair of shoes, they're 90% of the way there.
Okay. So what does the first hour of your day look like? I'm actually interested in this one.
Okay. So I get up at 5 every morning, occasionally earlier, but I set my alarm for 5. I'm a routine-oriented guy. I'm as into business and kind of entrepreneurship as I am fitness. And so I get up at 5 every single morning because the work for me is better at that time. My phone isn't going off, my family still sleeps, my wife is a stay-at-home mom, we homeschool our kiddos, so I have a house full of people, but at 5 a.m. they're also sleeping. And so I get up at 5 very first thing, I make a pot of great coffee, I'm kind of a coffee snob, and I sit down and I hammer the stuff that has to be done today first. And so I kind of have a goal. So what I do is I have a bunch of clients for online coaching. I break down their videos first, because every single day there are videos to be broken down. So I have videos of clients that I need to break down, just like a football coach would break down X's and O's on videos. And so I do that very first thing, try to get a pot of coffee. I do that for about 2 hours and try to get that stuff done. So I work in the business for 2 hours. And when that's over, it gives me the rest of the day to work on my business as much as I can. And so that's really my kind of standard routine.
Okay, and just coffee, or do you drink a bunch of water?
Yeah, so actually, great question. So always do a bottle of water, always do coffee, and I put powdered MCT oil from Quest in my coffee every single day. That's all I have. I don't intermittent fast as much as you do, but I typically don't eat anything until 11 a.m. in the morning. So 11 is usually the first time. Sometimes I'll have BCAAs in the water, depending on when I had dinner the night before. So if I had kind of an early dinner and it's actually been a long time to kind of stave off muscle wasting, I'll a lot of times put BCAAs in my water. So I'll have a bottle of water, maybe a couple bottles of water with a scoop or two of Sivation Extend BCAAs. And then I'll drink probably the majority of an entire pot of coffee and put, you know, one or two tablespoons total of MCT oil over those cups of coffee. So not one or two per cup, but
right.
but over across the thing. So
and MCT oil, for those who have no idea, the brief version is that it's going to be burned as fuel.
Yes.
Stored.
Yes. Medium chain triglycerides. Coconut oil is, I think, about 70% MCT. It's very quickly burned. It's a preferential fuel source. It's not readily stored as fat. It's an excellent fuel source, not just for your physical needs, but for mental, your brain. It gives your brain excellent power. So if you wake up in the morning and you're kind of groggy and you're like, man, I feel like I don't have a lot of brain energy, that's an excellent thing to use. I also spend a lot of time in ketosis, so I'll do a lot of time where I'm not eating carbs. And if that's the case, then I'll have exogenous ketone salts first thing in the morning as well. So for that same kind of idea. So yeah, that's my routine.
Awesome. You kind of already answered this, but coffee or energy drink?
Man, I never drink energy drinks.
Oh, okay.
Ever. I'm coffee till about 11 a.m. and I'm bourbon from 2 p.m. on.
Okay.
So I live my life going, is it too late to drink coffee all morning? And then in the afternoon I go, is it too early to drink bourbon? So I don't drink energy drinks. I used to when I was a middle school teacher. It's kind of funny. I think for me, energy drinks evoke an emotion that reminds me of what life was like when I was a public school teacher.
Okay.
And so I would get up every morning, I would stop at Casey's, I would get a Monster that had sugar in it, and I felt like crap, and I would drink it, but it was like this, I was in this addictive cycle of, I get up early, I don't want to go teach school, I'm going to pull in, it's like the one thing I have to look forward to in the morning is this Monster. And so that, I actually get this like, ugh, kind of feeling, and the hair stands up on the back of my neck. And so for me, I've converted completely to coffee.
Okay. You mentioned Extend a second ago, which I'm a fan of Extend and BCAAs too, but what I found is that energy drinks or Extend, which are both sweetened with sucralose,
yep.
like they, because I intermittent fast,
yep.
and they make me hungry.
Sure.
Like I won't be hungry before,
sure.
and they make me hungry.
Yeah, they ramp up your metabolism.
And a lot of people use them for the opposite reason.
Right, sure. Yep.
But
I get it.
Okay. Which is more important, a strong mind or a strong body?
Oh, it's here's the deal. You can't have a strong body without a strong mind. I really believe, like, I mean, you know, every once in a while you see the kid that was just kind of born to be strong and he was raised on a farm, but is being raised on a farm make you mentally tough? So I think that that's kind of a what comes first, the chicken or egg sort of question. Like, I don't think it's possible to be physically strong without being mentally strong. And I also think that the process of getting physically strong is a refining process to make us mentally strong. And so if you haven't squatted 3 sets of 5 heavy under a barbell on Monday, I mean heavy, where you've got enough weight on there, 315 or something, where you're grinding through and you don't think you're gonna finish all
right,
30
scares
sets.
You a little bit.
Yeah, scares you a little bit. And then you think, I gotta come back on Wednesday and put a few more pounds on the bar and do the exact same thing all over again. There's a refining process to that. And so almost everybody I have ever met that is physically strong is also mentally strong. The thing that I hope to convey to a lot of my friends who are mentally strong and not physically strong is that these things work hand in hand so well. So I do think you can be mentally strong and not physically strong, but I don't think that you can be physically strong without being mentally strong. So really, I think that mental toughness has to come first.
Right, and I think that the discipline, people always say, like, how do I get motivated to?
Yep.
And I say, you just decide, you get to be
yep.
disciplined.
Motivation doesn't matter, right?
Right.
So we always, there's a buddy of mine makes a shirt that says discipline, it's got the word discipline in the line, and motivate, yeah,
Wendler.
Jim Wendler. So
yeah.
Wendler's a good buddy of mine. So discipline over motivation, right?
Yeah.
Like, it doesn't matter. I got another friend, Nikki Sims, that says, fuck your feelings.
Yeah.
Because, like, your feelings don't matter. Like, and really, I mean, it's an important thing to understand that when I exercise, like, if what I'm doing is exercise, which is not what I do and not what you do and not what we teach our clients to do, exercise is about today. It's about the way I feel. It's about making me hot and sweaty. It's about going and walking on a purple treadmill and reading Cosmo magazine and checking it off the list because it makes me feel good. When we train to be harder to kill, to be stronger, then our feelings don't matter. It doesn't matter if you get up and don't want to train. We train. Like Usain Bolt, fastest guy on earth, he trains every day to be the fastest guy on earth. You know there are days that he wakes up and he goes, I really don't want to run today. Well, that's fine. Do you want to be the strongest, the fastest guy on earth? Yes, you have to train. And it's the same thing here. Do you want to be harder to kill? Then we're working towards a goal. So training is not about today. Training is about out here. There's a goal out in the future that today I'm working toward. Another step, a quantifiable way that I can make sure that I'm getting closer to that goal. Exercise is about feeling good today. It's about getting hot and sweaty today. And so that's the way we differentiate exercise and training.